Lesson 4, Economy, Its Meaning and Types. I am Dr. Kartar Singh, Associate Professor, Jamia Millia Islamia in New Delhi. Dear learners, in this lesson, we are going to talk about meaning of an economy and its types. Types of economy on the basis of level of development. Meaning of economic development. Determinants of economic development and distinction between economic development and economic growth. The purpose of every economy is to satisfy human wants by using limited or scarce resources available and known to a society. These wants can be satisfied by production and consumption of goods and services. For production, the factors of production are engaged in some economic activities. These economic activities bring income to the economic agents that can either be consumed or saved and invested. On account of these gainful economic activities and accumulated earnings, some countries grow fast, while others cannot attain such level of high growth rate. As a result, some economies attain the status of developed economies, while others remain underdeveloped or can say developing economies. They are also known as rich and poor economies. We can look at economies on the basis of ownership of resources. The resources available may be in private ownership or the collective ownership. Thus, there are different ways to look at the economy and its level of development. In this lesson, we will explain all these terms in a simple way so that you may understand and differentiate the meaning and nature of an economy and understand its various types. Number one, meaning of an economy. An economy is a man-made organization for the satisfaction of human wants. According to A.J. Brown, an economy is a system by which people get living. The way man attempts to get a living differs in major respects from time to time and from place to place. In primitive times, get a living was simple, but with growth of civilization, it has become much more complex. Here, it is important to note that the way person earns his or her living must be legal and fair. Unfair and illegal means such as robbery, smuggling may earn income for oneself, but should not be taken into consideration as gainful economic activity or a system of get a living. It will therefore be appropriate to call that economy is a framework where all economic activities are carried out. Some of the salient features of an economy are as follows. Number one, economic institutions are man-made. Thus, an economy is what we make it. Number two, economic institutions can be created, destroyed, replaced, or changed. For example, the capitalism was replaced by communism in 1917 in USSR, and the communism was destroyed in 1989 through a series of economic reforms by former USSR. In India, after independence in 1947, through economic and social reforms, we abolished zamindari system and introduced many land reforms. Number three is levels of economic activities keep on changing. Number four, producers and consumers are the same persons. Thus, they have a dual role. As producers, they work and produce certain goods and services and consume the same as consumers. Number fifth, production, consumption and investment are the vital processes of an economy. Number six, in modern complex economies, we use money as a medium of exchange. Number seven, nowadays, the government intervention in the economy is considered undesirable and the preference for free functioning of prices and market forces is increasing in all types of economic system. Let us now understand the types of economies. As you know that economy is a man-made organization which is created, destroyed or changed as the requirement of the society. We can differentiate in various types of economic system on the basis of following criteria. Number one criteria is on the basis of ownership and control over means of production or resources. Resources or means of production remain either in private ownership with full individual freedom to use them for the profit motive, or they can be in collective ownership, can say on government control, and can be used for the collective welfare of the society as a whole. Based on the criterion of degree of individual freedom and profit motive, economies are labeled as number one, capitalist or free enterprise economy, number two, socialist or centrally planned economy, number three, mixed economy. Now, we shall discuss about the main characteristics of these economies in brief. Number one, capitalist economy. The capitalist or free enterprise economy is the oldest form of economy. Earlier, economists supported the policy of laissez-faire, meaning leave free. They advocated minimum government intervention in the economic activities. The following are the main features of a capitalist economy. Number one, private property. In a capitalism system, all the individuals have the right to own property. An individual can acquire property and use it for the benefit of his own family. There is no restriction on the ownership of land, machines, mines, factories, and to earn profit. After the death of a person, the property or wealth is transferred to the legal heirs. Thus, the institution of private property is sustained over time by the right of inheritance. Number two, freedom of enterprise. In a capitalist economy, the government does not coordinate production decisions of the individuals, citizens. Individuals are free to choose any occupation. Freedom of enterprise implies that business firms are free to acquire resources and use them in the production of any good or service. The firms are also free to sell their product in the markets of their choice. A worker is free to choose his or her employer. In small business units, owner himself takes the risk of production and earns profit or loss for himself. But in modern corporations, the stakeholders take risk, whereas paid directors manage businesses. Thus, the individual supervision of one's own capital is now no longer required to earn profit. Government or any other agency does not impose restrictions, obstacles in the way of workers to enter or leave a particular industry. A worker chooses that occupation where his income is maximum. Number third characteristics of capitalist economy is consumer's sovereignty. In a capitalist economy, consumers are like a king. They have the full freedom to spend their income on goods and services that they give them maximum satisfaction. In capitalist system, production is guided by consumer's choice. This freedom of consumers is called consumer's sovereignty. Number fourth, profit motive. Self-interest is the guiding principle in capitalism. Entrepreneurs, now that they will own the profit or loss after the payment of all other factors of production. Therefore, they are always motivated to maximize their residual profit by minimizing cost and maximizing revenue. This makes the capitalist economy an efficient and self-regulated economy. Number fifth is competition. There are no restrictions on the entry and exit of the firms in a capitalism system. The large number of producers are available to supply a particular good or service, and therefore no firm can earn more than normal profit. Competition is the fundamental feature of capitalist economy and essential to safeguard against consumers' exploitation. although due to large size and production distinction, monopolistic tendencies have grown these days, still the competition can be seen among a large number of firms. Number 6, importance of markets and prices. The important feature of capitalism like private property, freedom of choice, profit motive and competition make a room for free and efficient functioning of price mechanism. Capitalism is essentially a market economy where every commodity has a price. The forces of demand and supply in an industry determine this price. Firms which are available to adjust at a given price earn normal profit, and those who fail to do so often quit the industry. A producer will produce those goods which give him more profit. Number 6 is absence of government interference. In a free enterprise or capitalist economy, the price system plays an important role of coordinating agent. Government intervention and support is not required. The role of government is to help in free and efficient functioning of the markets. Then, capitalism in today's world. Pure capitalism is not seen in the world. Nowadays, the economies of USA, UK, France, Netherlands, Spain, Portugal, Australia, etc. are known as of their respective government in economic development. Second type of economy is socialist economy. In the socialist or centrally planned economy, all the productive resources are owned and controlled by the government in the overall interest of the society. A central planning authority takes the decisions. The socialist economy has the following main features. Number 1 is collective ownership of means of production. In a socialist economy, means of production are owned by the government on behalf of the people. The institution of private property is abolished and no individual is allowed to own any production unit and accumulate wealth and transfer it to their heirs. However, people may own some durable consumer goods for their personal use. Number 3 characteristic is social welfare objective. The decisions are taken by the government at macro level with the objective of maximization of social welfare in mind rather than maximization of individual profit. The forces of demand and supply do not play an important role. Carefully, decisions are taken with the welfare objectives in mind. Third characteristic is central planning. Economic planning is an essential feature of a socialist economy. The central planning authority keeping the national priorities and availability of resources in mind allocates resources. Government takes all economic decisions regarding production, consumption, and investing, keeping in mind the present and future needs. The planning authorities fix targets for various sectors and ensure their efficient utilization of resources. Number 4th one is reduction in inequalities. The institutions of private property and inheritance are at the root of inequalities of income and wealth in a capitalist economy. By abolishing these own institutions, a socialist economic system is able to reduce the inequalities of income. It is important to note that perfect equality in income and wealth is neither desirable nor practicable. Number 5th characteristic is no class conflict. In capitalist economy, the interests of the workers and management are different. Both of them want to maximize their own individual profit or earnings. This results in class conflict in capitalist economy. In socialist, there is no competition among classes. Every person is a worker, so there is no class conflict. All are co-workers. Then socialism in today's world. Countries such as Russia, China, and many Eastern European countries are said to be socialist countries. But they are changing now and encouraging liberalization in their countries for their economic development. Third type of economy is mixed economy. A mixed economy combines the best features of capitalism and socialism. Thus, mixed economy has some elements of both free enterprise or capitalist economy as well as a government-controlled socialist economy. The public and private sectors coexist in mixed economy. The main characteristics of a mixed economy are as follows. Number one, coexistence of public and private sectors. The private sector consists of production units that are owned privately and work on the basis of profit motive. The public sector consists of production units owned by the government and works on the basis of social welfare. The areas of economic activities of each sector are generally democratic, can say demarcated. Government uses its various policies, example, licensing policy, taxation policy, price policy, monetary policy, and fiscal policy to control and regulate the private sector. Number second characteristics of mixed economy is individual freedom. Individuals take up economic activities to maximize their personal income. They are free to choose any occupation and consume as per their choice. But producers are not given the freedom to exploit consumers and laborers. Government puts some restrictions, keeping in mind the welfare of the people. For example, government may put restrictions on the production and consumption of harmful goods, but within rules, regulations, and restrictions imposed by the government for the welfare of the society, the private sector enjoys complete freedom. Number third characteristic is economic planning. The government prepares long-term plans and decides the roles to be played by the private and public sectors in the development of the economy. The public sector is under direct control of the government. As such, production targets and plans are formulated for them directly. The private sector is provided encouragement, incentives, support, and subsidies to work as per national priorities. Number fourth characteristic is price mechanism. Prices play a significant role in the allocation of resources. For some sectors, the policy of administered prices is adopted. Government also provides price subsidies to help the target group. The aim of the government is to maximize the welfare of the masses. For those who cannot afford to purchase the goods at market prices, government makes the goods available either free of cost or at below market, or can say at subsidized prices. Thus, in a mixed economy, people at large enjoy individual freedom and government support to protect the interests of weaker sections of the society. Indian economy is considered a mixed economy as it has well-defined areas for functioning of public and private sectors and economic planning. Even countries such as USA, UK, etc., which were known as capitalistic countries, are also called mixed economies. Now, they because of active role of their government in economic development. The next point is types of economies on the basis of level of development. On the basis of level of development, economies can be classified into two categories. Number one, developed economy. Number two, developing economy. The countries are labeled developed or rich and developing or poor on the basis of real national and per capita income and standard of living of its population. Developed countries have higher national and per capita income, high rate of capital formation, that high savings and investment. They have highly educated human resources, better civic facilities, health and sanitation facilities, low birth rate, low death rate, low infant mortality, developed industrial and social infrastructure, and a strong financial and capital market. In short, developed countries have high standard of living. On the other hand, developing countries are low on the ladder of development. They are sometimes also called underdeveloped, backward, or poor countries. But Economists prefer to call them developing countries because it gives a sense of dynamism. The national and per capita income is low in these countries. They have backward agricultural and industrial sectors with low savings, investment and capital formation. Although these countries have export earnings, but generally they export primary agricultural products. In short, they have low standard of living and poor health and sanitation, high infant mortality, high birth and death rates, and poor infrastructure. Thus, economic development depends on many factors and has different meanings. Although you have already read, it will be useful to discuss again the meaning of economic development, its determinants, and the difference between the terms economic development and economic growth. In the context of present lesson, the meaning of economic development is, or let us first discuss the meaning of economic growth. Economic growth, as distinguished from economic development, is a sustained increase in national income, taking the differences in population into consideration. It is reflected in the growth of per capita income, that national income divided by total population. Although there may be year-to-year fluctuations or short-term variations in the growth of national income, there has to be a continuous growth in national income in the long run for it to qualify as economic growth. On the other hand, economic development includes not only economic growth, but also various other economic changes that improve the quality of life or standard of living of people in a country. If with economic growth, a country experiences various economic changes such as reduction in poverty and unemployment, reduction in income and wealth inequality, increase in literacy rate, improvement in health and hygiene, decrease in population growth, improvement in environmental standards, etc., that improve the quality of life, then that is economic development. Such economic changes that are conducive to improvements in standards of living of people are necessary for economic development. Otherwise, people's standard of living may not improve in spite of economic growth. It may happen that with economic growth, the rich get richer while the poor get poorer if the fruits of growth are snatched by the richer sections of the society. Clearly, economic development is a much broader concept than economic growth. It not only includes economic growth, but also various other economic changes that bring about improvement in the standard of living of people or quality of life. Now, we will discuss determinants of economic development. The process of economic development is influenced by a number of economic as well as non-economic factors. The important economic factors are as follows. Number one, natural resources. The availability of natural resources facilitate and accelerate economic growth and economic development. It is believed that quality and quantity of natural resources affect the rate of growth. Second is human resources. Another important determinant of economic development is the quantity and quality of human resources or the population. Other things being equal, educated and technically qualified manpower helps in achieving higher growth rate. On the other hand, illiterate and unskilled population retards the economic growth. Number third is capital formation. Stock of capital goods is crucial for rapid economic growth. For increasing the stock of capital, rate of savings must be high. The savings must be invested. Given the rate of savings and investment, the rate of growth will depend upon capital output ratio. If the domestic savings are not sufficient, government can seek external assistance to increase capital formation and growth rate in developing countries. Number fourth point is technology. Technology can play an important role in the economic development. Technological process depends on continuous research and development. Through technological progress, a nation may overcome other constraints such as scarcity of natural resources and low productivity. Developed economies invest in its human capital. Besides these economic factors, many other non-economic factors such as caste system, family type, racial factors and government policies also affect the rate of growth and economic development. It is very difficult to measure economic development and to give one index of economic development. The most commonly used index of economic development, that increase in per capita income, suffers from a serious drawback. This index does not take into account the consumption of natural resources and environmental degradation, such as the smoke from the industries or the pollution caused by the various industrial waste and by products in the air and water resources. The cutting of forest and selling of timber will earn income and will be considered an economic activity and the income added in the national income statistics, but the harm caused by deforestation will not be shown as a negative entry in the national accounts statistics. The economists therefore are seriously working on preparation of some new index that may account for these environment costs to the society and can be as a welfare index of the society. Distinction between economic development and economic growth. Economic growth is a short-term measure and is generally refers to year-to-year rise in national and per capita income in real terms. But the income index does not take into account the distributional aspects of national income. Another important thing is that income approach does not take into account the unproductive and dysfunction growth and productive and socially useful growth. Economic development, on the other hand, is a long-term measure over a long period. The economic development refers to overall rise in standard of living and a better quality of life. Besides income index, some non-income indices are also taken into account. These are high life expectancy at birth, low infant mortality, and high rate of literacy. An improvement in these non-income indices imply that the quality of life has also improved. Some important institutions like UNESCO and ILO, International Labour Organization, include the basic needs approach, such as availability of food, clothing and shelter. Availability of drinking water, sanitation and public transport facilities, good health and education as an index of economic development. The objective of development, therefore, is meeting the needs of the vast masses of population. The United Nations development programs emphasize on human development index that is based on per capita income, educational attainment and life expectancy. Thus, it is a composite index of economic and social indicators. The economic development, therefore, is a much wider term to capture overall improvement in the quality of life of people. Dear students, now you got a good idea about the meaning of an economy, types of economies on the basis of level of development, meaning of economic development, determinants of economic development, and distinction between economic development and economic growth. Thank you.